The next item of business is a motion to approve a statutory rule. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That the draft Housing Benefit Welfare Supplementary Payment Regulations Northern Ireland 2017 be approved.
Thank you, and I call the Minister for Communities.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to move that the Housing Benefit Welfare Supplementary Payment Regulations Northern Ireland 2017 be approved. These draft regulations are needed to provide my department with the powers to make payments to ensure 34,000 households do not suffer financially when the social sector size criteria, otherwise known as the bedroom tax, is applied in Northern Ireland on the 20th of February. Whilst it has not been possible to bring the draft regulations to either the Executive or the Committee for the Department of Communities in advance of bringing them to the Assembly floor today, it has been suggested by some MLAs that my department already has the powers under the Budget Act or Section 59 of the Northern Ireland Act 1998, and there is no need for me to come to the Assembly to seek approval of the draft regulations. Members of this House are all too well aware of the complexity of social security legislation. Indeed, in the past number of months, this House has voted on four separate sets of regulations to give my department the necessary powers to protect those people who have been impacted by the changes to the welfare system. This reflects the long-established approach to social welfare, which is based on a solid foundation where legislation and regulations specify the terms and conditions upon which social welfare payments are made and administered. It would strike me as extraordinary that some MLAs could be suggesting that we should try to operate a social security system and make mitigation payments on the basis of the general powers provided for under the Budget Act or Section 59 of the Northern Ireland Act, rather than the legislative powers set down in the Welfare Reform Order and which was agreed by the Executive. Indeed, in recent days, my Permanent Secretary has provided me with detailed legal advice from the Attorney General, which clearly states that neither the Budget Act and Section 59 provide any legal basis for the type of scheme set out in the draft regulations. This advice clearly states that these only provide the Department with the power to spend money, but do not provide the legal framework for the application of that money. Members are able to see from the draft set of regulations that the general provisions in the Budget Act would not give my Department the powers necessary to make decisions in the different scenarios set out in the regulations. So, Mr. Speaker, that nails everything that the Finance Minister has been doing whilst he's engaged in a Twitter battle. The public can see who the twit is as he's went along, making it up on social media in respect to how this is being issued. The regulations which I am bringing to the Assembly today.
Point of order.
I can ask the Speaker to rule on the use of inappropriate language like twit, which the member has just said. Can I ask the member to rule on temperate language?
I would ask that all members moderate their language and that we show respect right around the chamber on any matter as we go through today.
Well, Mr. Speaker, we all know too well what Sinn Féin's agenda is when it comes to respect. Equality, the Trojan horse to break the unionists, and then they know what Gerry Adams said thereafter in respect of the unionist population. When I tell you, Mr. Speaker, we'll not be lectured about respect from the members opposite, and we will continue to maintain our positions that are principled, that are based on sound values, and we will not allow the twisting of what equality really is all about, and unionists know exactly Sinn Féin's agenda when it comes to equality. The regulations which I am bringing to the Assembly today are being brought in under Article 137A of the Welfare Reform and Work Order Northern Ireland 2016, and will make provision for welfare supplementary payment to ensure claimants are not financially disadvantaged by the changes to housing benefit introduced under Article 75 of the order. The social sector size criteria will change how housing benefit is calculated for working age claimants who have a tenancy in an housing executive or housing association properties. Pensioners will not be affected by this change. The change to housing benefit will bring restrictions to entitlement to housing benefit where a claimant is under occupying a property. Accordingly, those claimants who occupy a property which is larger than their household size warrants will see a reduction in their housing benefit payment. Data provided by the Northern Ireland Housing Executive suggests that as at May 2015, these changes could affect up to 33,916 households in receipt of housing benefit. The regulations will give my department the powers to make welfare supplementary payments to current and future housing benefit claimants who qualify for a payment over the life of the Fresh Start Agreement until March 2020. The Executive will review the operation of the mitigation scheme in 2018-19. The Department will identify housing benefit claimants who are eligible for mitigation, and claimants will automatically receive their welfare supplementary payment. Claimants will not have to apply for a welfare supplementary payment. The welfare supplementary payment will be calculated to ensure the claimant does not incur any financial disadvantage as a result of the application of the size criteria to their housing benefit entitlement. Welfare supplementary payments will cease where the claimant is no longer entitled to housing benefit or where the social sector size criteria no longer applies to them. If the claimant undergoes a change of circumstances that alters the application of the SSC to their housing benefit entitlement, their welfare supplementary payment will either increase or decrease to reflect this change. Welfare supplementary payments will also increase in accordance with rent increases in the social rented sector, and claimants will receive their welfare supplementary payment 4 weekly in arrears throughout the mitigation period until March 2020. If a claimant is receiving a welfare supplementary payment and they transfer to another property in the social rented sector in which they under-occupy at a lower level, they will continue to receive a welfare supplementary payment at that reduced level. If a claimant is receiving welfare supplementary payment and they transfer to another property in the social rented sector where they continue to under-occupy to the same or a greater extent than their previous property, they will then no longer receive a welfare supplementary payment. Claimants will retain their mitigation payment if they transfer to another property in the social rented sector under one of the management transfer scheme categories. This scheme makes a claimant a priority to be moved and includes claimants who need to move because of domestic violence or where claimants need to move to an adapted home due to disability or long-term illness. In the majority of situations, the supplementary payment will be made directly to the landlord. In situations where the claimant normally receives their housing benefit directly, they will also receive their welfare supplementary payment directly. I can also confirm that these welfare supplementary payments will be disregarded when considering a person's entitlement to social security benefits or working tax credits, and that they will not be taxable. Mr. Speaker, I appreciate that some members of the House may have concerns that the regulations contained within provisions that provide for the welfare supplementary payments to be stopped in cases where an individual decides to leave their current tenancy and move to a new house where they are under-occupying at the same level or indeed an increased level. As Minister with responsibility for housing as well as social welfare, I have to balance my responsibilities to manage the social housing stock whilst protecting individuals impacted by the new arrangements for housing benefit when they are making decisions on whether to move house. It is important that members are aware that these provisions do not apply to tenants who have to move house because of domestic violence, intimidation, or a range of other circumstances that are set out in the managed transfer list. However, I'm also conscious of concerns of members, and in response to those concerns, I am committing today to publish on a 6-monthly basis the number of households who may have their mitigation stopped as a consequence of provisions in Regulation 2. If these numbers are considered excessive, I am also committing to go back to the Executive for them to consider a review of the regulations if required, and I hope that that commitment would allay members' concerns and will enable them to support the regulations to ensure 34,000 householders will receive the financial support they require on February. So, Mr. Speaker, let me be clear. Because of the actions that Sinn Féin has taken, whilst all of that debate has been going on, I have been very clear that the most vulnerable should not be used. during this election campaign, and that's why I have engaged since the actions of Sinn Féin to seek a resolution through the extraordinary measures that I'm having to take today in the absence of there being executive. Because irrespective of the political campaign that will now take place during this election, we must not allow the most vulnerable in our society to be paying the price because of the actions of Sinn Féin. Not just Sinn Féin wanted the election. People before profit said, let's have a riot at the ballot box. The consequences of that approach is to put at risk 34,000 people to the bedroom tax, because the 20th of February is when bedroom tax comes in to Northern Ireland. That date is in primary legislation. It cannot be changed. But we have the ability, through a mitigation process, which we in this party wanted to protect people from the bedroom tax, today, by voting for these regulations, not one person will be faced with the bedroom tax. That is the responsible thing for MLAs to be doing, given the crises that these institutions now find themselves in, on this, the last day of the sitting of this Assembly. I trust that there will be a return to these institutions after, clearly, the negotiations that will now need to take place because of the actions of Sinn Féin. And at that point, MLAs will be able to revisit this. But let me be clear. I'm not going to give way. Let me be clear. We're taking these actions today on these unprecedented circumstances to protect the most vulnerable. Sinn Féin wanted to use the most vulnerable, shamefully, as part of this process. Whilst I deal with bedroom tax, unfortunately, there will be other people on waiting lists needing surgery. There will be other people who will have consequences in the voluntary community sector because of there not being a budget because of the Finance Minister's failure. So I have taken this action on bedroom tax, but let's make no mistake about it. Their actions mean people are going to suffer.
Minister, I have received a point of order from Mr. Andy Allen.
Mr. Speaker, I would ask that the Minister comes back to the regulation before us and not proceed to party politic in referring to other matters that have nothing in direct relation to this regulation.
That's not a point of order, Mr. Allen. Minister, continue. Well, can I just before the Minister does, apologies to the Minister. The Minister referred to this being the last day of the Assembly. This is not the last day of the Assembly. There is a business scheduled for tomorrow. Minister.
Okay. I'm sure that detail will be well received. In terms of where we're at today, we dealt with the bedroom tax as part of the mitigation measures brought forward by this executive. A demonstration of how this executive did work, and did work in achieving key issues for the people that we represent. For 2.5 years, Sinn Féin refused in respect of welfare reform. In 2.5 years, Sinn Féin cost the public purse £174 million in penalties from the Treasury. Money that was lost in the public services in 2.5 years. And what did we do whenever these issues were raised? We worked through them, despite the reckless activities of Sinn Féin that cost £174 million. We worked through those difficulties, Mr. Speaker. We came forward with a mitigation package of £500 million to protect the most vulnerable. Within that was the bedroom tax. And isn't it ironic that Sinn Féin bring the institutions down over the bedroom tax, which I am now seeking to deal with?
I have a point of order from Mrs. Long.
Mr. Speaker, I realise that the Minister has mentioned that there is an election campaign, but he is speaking here as a Minister and not as a candidate. Would it be possible for him to return himself to the detail of the legislation rather than simply attack his opponents?
I understand the point the Member is making. It's not a point of order, though. Minister King.
Mr. Speaker, all of the points that I make relate entirely to the regulation around the bedroom tax. Every single point. I understand why others don't want now for the truth to be told, because they're worried about the election. We will go out and fight the election and put our cause to the people. So let me conclude, Mr. Speaker, in respect of this. I'm taking these actions despite the politicking of Sinn Féin to protect the most vulnerable. And I would appeal to members This is the only way that we can stop the bedroom tax being introduced because of the reckless activity of Sinn Féin, to protect those 34,000 people. And let us move on in this political campaign, which clearly now has started, and we will fight those issues on the doorsteps. But the most vulnerable should not be used by Sinn Féin as part of their party political agenda. I beg to move.
I call Mr. Andrew Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Like many, I've watched with mixed emotions at the events that's brought us to this scenario where a regulation has to be brought before the Assembly without going through the proper mechanisms, being brought before the Executive and scrutinised by the Committee. I do realise that both the Finance Minister and the Minister for Communities would rather resort to party politicking and using some of the most vulnerable in society as an opportunity to get one-upmanship on one another. Whilst they were going on to social media, Twitter and The View, and trying to one-up on each other, I was liaising and dealing with constituents who had major concern and fears that they would have to choose between heating their home, feeding themselves, or paying this bedroom tax. It's also important to point out and contextualise why we need the bedroom tax, because under successive DUP ministers, they have not, I repeat, built enough social housing to be able to meet the needs of those that downsize. On a daily and a regular basis, Mr. Speaker, I deal with constituents who have attempted to downsize, and in the housing selection scheme, there is no provision made for those that downsize. Yes, they will perhaps receive under occupation points, but they won't receive enough points in order to compete with the continuing spiralling out of control waiting lists. So it's important, whilst the DUP try to continually say that they are protecting the most vulnerable, they have done nothing. They haven't built enough social houses over the years, and that is fact. It is clear fact. The Minister came to this House and said he's going to build 9,600 houses, and we hope we see that. The Ulster Unionist Party firmly support these regulations before us because we believe that those most vulnerable in our society should be protected. And whilst the Minister again was politicking on social media, we were liaising through other channels, and we didn't have to go out and politic. We were liaising with Westminster and we were liaising with the Housing Executive to ensure that those the most vulnerable in our society will not be impacted by these bedroom taxes. But we didn't go out and politic.
And the member is very eloquently talking about the need for a bedroom tax, but could then the member then explain why his party actually voted against the mitigation package, which included the subsidies towards bedroom tax?
I thank the member for his intervention, and it's important to remember we're in the here and now, and I'm clearly stating that we support the regulation before us. We support the mitigation for the most vulnerable in our society. Mr. Speaker, no one needs to explain to me the impact that this will have, because as I've outlined, I have liaised and dealt with many constituents who have highlighted their concerns and their fears. So whilst the rest of us have no fear in going to the electorate and putting ourselves forward, the DUP and Sinn Féin no doubt will continue to politic with some of the most vulnerable in our society when Sinn Féin members can't even make themselves available for a committee meeting to scrutinise welfare reform and hear from individuals around the potential closure of JBOs. We support the regulation, Mr. Speaker.
I call Ms. Carol McQuillan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's quite obvious that there's a lot of defence tactics going on, particularly by the Minister and his party. And he's right, I'll agree with him in this. Had Sinn Féin not stood firm to ensure that the most vulnerable were protected, and to ensure that they were protected properly, irrespective of legislation coming from Westminster, then we all collectively would have been in a much different position. We stood by our convictions, and to the best of our ability, we got a deal to protect those most vulnerable. In relation to fines, the people and the claimants that we all talk about, not one penny came out of their pockets. Yes, it came out of our block grant, but let's be clear about that. Why? Because while people were waxing lyrical about the need to ensure that our block grant was protected over one shoulder, they failed to look over another shoulder. And then, sorry, I would.
I accept what the member is saying. She's waxing lyrical herself. But perhaps you could explain why the members of Parliament that actually have been elected for Sinn Féin didn't go to Westminster and actually fight the legislation there?
Well, I think our position on abstentionism in terms of Westminster has always been out for the, when the elections are on, we've always put our case to the public. And on the basis of an abstentionist approach, the public have returned. So if you're questioning the public's ability to make a rational decision in terms of a vote, then you do that. But at the time when you're making silly points with respect, your party was hitching itself up to the Tories to implement cuts here and right across, irrespective, with no mitigation packages, with no protections, absolutely nothing. So I'm accepting what the member is saying with a very, very small pinch of salt. In relation to protecting people, I'm actually glad to see that there is a review built into this legislation, these regulations are coming for, particularly around the change of circumstances. I think without a review, it would have been perhaps ridiculous because you would have seen the potential for people who were downsizing properties actually saving the public purse money but getting penalised down the road. So that makes a lot of sense. I'm also happy to see that the need for, or perhaps even through social landlords, that there will be processes on board to ensure that if there is any circumstances, and the Minister outlined management transfers and all the issues relating to that. But there's also people who fall in between some of those categories through no fault of their own, and that needs to be taken into consideration. I'm actually quite proud, and I'll take no lectures from Paul Givan or any member of his party, quite proud of our stance over our protections for welfare reform. I would surely.
Yeah. It's not that long ago when the second element of welfare reform was coming in front of this House that a DUP minister at a meeting in Belfast stood up and said that he couldn't expect us to be treated any different from the way the people in Manchester, London or Liverpool. And he was talking about that in relation to the mitigation measures and about the bedroom tax.
And for me, that says it all, and that's why we wanted to ensure that we stood firm to make sure that these mitigation packages happened. So we won't be taking any lectures on that. We won't be treating people with disrespect. We won't be treating them with arrogance either. And we want to make sure that all these regulations and any that come after, and particularly their implementation, is open and transparent. The thing is that people, all the fears and even some of the straplines out there, that people who are on benefits are going to be impacted. These regulations brought in will now ensure that all that scaremongering out there is ceased. Oh, wait, surely.
The member has just said that these regulations will ensure that the people out there are protected. Is she conceding that what we were told via the media by her colleague Martine O'Muller, that they were protected simply by dint of existing legislation then, is not correct?
No, to be honest now, you're making a political point. You are making a political point.
It's a political chamber.
OK, it is a political chamber, and you're a politician, and so am I. But the regulations are here. And unless we insisted the due diligence and the exercising of responsibility around ministerial duties happened, then we wouldn't even be sitting here, and we would have found a way to ensure that people weren't penalised. It's really easy. It's really, really easy for everybody to get on and dance to someone else's tune. I think what we're all genuine about is making sure that people who are in difficult circumstances financially aren't further disadvantaged. And I think that's where the member's coming from. Certainly.
I mean, there is absolutely no question that that is where everyone in the chamber is coming from, but this is a serious point. The Minister for Finance said that there was no need for these regulations to be brought, that the flow of money would continue. That's an assurance that not only applies to these regulations, but to a whole host of other monies that he has provided the same assurance about. Was he right or was he wrong?
No, he's not wrong, Naomi. The money's there. At our insistence, with our due diligence in the executive, making sure the money's there, people at their desks doing their jobs. So I'm not getting into a whole back and forward, as much as we could do this all day. I'm accepting that the minister, the member, is coming from a position that she wanted to ensure the people who were listening to scaremongering on the radio were protected, and I believe that they are today. And I believe that they are with the insistence of our party and with the support of other people who eventually came to our position. So on that basis, I'm happy to support these regulations.
Ms. Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We're here today to debate regulation, which, in all honesty, there is a lack of detail on, and there is a lack of time that it deserves given the importance of this issue. This has been handled shambolically, and listening to the tone of the debate and the fact that, very sadly, the Minister has opted to use his contribution more as a pre-election pitch than to deal really with the issues that are in front of us is something that I find deeply disappointing. Let's be clear. We wouldn't be in this position if, as the SDLP, had argued that mitigation of the bedroom tax was not put into legislation. We feared that this mishandling might happen. We feared that it might fall victim to party politicking, either here in this chamber or across the water. And that's why we signed a petition of concern. We had hoped, and we were told at the time, that others were going to put forward a petition of concern for exactly the same reasons. That verbal commitment was never followed up by substantial action. And so we find ourselves here in this position today. Fresh Start was heralded, Mr. Speaker, with much fanfare. And in fact, the mitigation around the bedroom tax was specifically singled out as a shining example of how the executive was delivering for some of our most vulnerable citizens. I have to say, Mr. Speaker, I have listened to statements and I have watched incidents unfold over several weeks and months. But the political brinkmanship that has been played with our most vulnerable over the mitigation of the bedroom tax is something that I have found profoundly obscene, and I do not use that term lightly. In a minute, Christopher. The Minister publicly stated, Mr. Speaker, that there was very little to nothing that he could do to prevent or to bring forward the mitigation measures to protect our most vulnerable from the bedroom tax. He said that, Mr. Speaker, without knowing categorically that that was the truth. Why, in my opinion, in my humble opinion, do I believe that he did it? Because he wanted to put pressure on his partners in government and prevent them calling an election. But what his comments did do, Mr. Speaker, was they terrified 34,000 vulnerable citizens in my constituency and in each and every constituency across this chamber. People who couldn't sleep at night, in a minute, Alex, people who couldn't sleep at night because they were being told that they were facing the prospect of being slapped with a bedroom tax. That is what the Minister for Communities, the Minister responsible for protecting our most vulnerable, did. I'll give way to Mr. Stalford and then I'll give way to Mr. Mann.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. The member's absolutely right that at the core of this issue are 34,000 people who potentially faced having the bedroom tax imposed upon them. Would she agree that in that context it was right that the minister sought advice from the Attorney General, whilst the Sinn Féin minister at the heart of this issue simply published a note that he received from his permanent secretary? So in fact it was the Minister for Communities who sought the definitive legal position before making it public.
Mr. Stalford, what I believe should have happened is that, acting responsibly as ministers, they should have went and sought legal advice. They should have came to a considered and guaranteed position before they went to the airwaves to terrify the most vulnerable across our society. I found it deeply disappointing that both ministers engaged in a battle along the airwaves when they should have, despite the party politicking and the electioneering that's going on, they should have stepped aside and in private had the conversations that were required of two executive ministers to bring certainty to the people who needed it the most. Mr. Maskey.
Thank you, Ms. Mullen, for giving way. But I mean, could I ask could the member not reflect and perhaps explain that the 30-odd thousand people that you rightly say would be very worried at the prospect of having to pay the bedroom tax, could the member explain how on earth you can say that at the same time, when if your party had its way last year, then the bedroom tax would not be mitigated against. Your party voted against the £500 million mitigation package. £500 million your party and your party, Mr Nesbitt, voted against. So square that one.
Quite clearly and succinctly, I'll square it. If it wasn't put in legislation, then it wouldn't have been happening. Anyway, I'll draw my remarks to a conclusion, Mr Speaker. Some things are too important to play party politics with. The lives of the vulnerable, I believe, are one of those. And sadly, people have played politics, particularly in the last number of weeks. And to see for the 34,000 people who have been treated like this, to be sitting listening to this tone of debate, it isn't any wonder that people don't have faith in politics here, Mr. Speaker. Yes, I will.
Thank the member for giving way. Does the member agree with me that we are now in a situation where we're heading into an election? We don't know what's going to happen at the far end of that election. There's a real possibility that these powers could again be back as they rest with the Tory government in London. We have this legislation in legislation, in primary legislation. As the Minister says, it is now in primary legislation with the bedroom tax, and that cannot be changed. That's the Minister's words. Are people not concerned that if we go into a situation of collapse and suspension, that the Tory government will come in and bring the benefit tax or some other, the bedroom tax or some other draconian form of legislation into Northern Ireland, that it won't matter what we've done around mitigation, that it'll be too late at that point?
I want to thank the member for his intervention, and I think that sadly that is the very, very real case. But I look forward to hearing other people in this chamber from other political parties providing the answer to Mr Eastwood's question. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
I call Ms Naomi Long.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Before I make my remarks with respect to the regulations which are in front of us, I want to make it very clear that the only interest in our mind in coming to this issue is to ensure that those who are in uncertainty, that those who are concerned by what they saw in the media over the last number of days, with two ministers who are in the same government disputing each other's position on this, raising concerns in the minds of vulnerable people about their future, that is put to bed today, and that they go forward with some degree of certainty and reassurance. When we see people in our constituency offices who are struggling to make ends meet, coming to us genuinely afraid for their future because they know that they could first of all not find suitable accommodation in order to be able to find somewhere else to live were the bedroom tax to be introduced, but more than that, that they would not be able to pay the bills in the interim were they not covered by legislation here with these mitigation measures. When you see those people who come to your office with those concerns, how you can continue to bluster around this issue as though it's only an issue of party politics between two competing forces in here is absolutely beyond me. It is scandalous. I am concerned still, Mr. Speaker, because we have not had an opportunity to properly scrutinise the regulations that are before us today. We have not had the opportunity as a committee to hear the Minister in detail, to hear the legal advice which he has received, to scrutinise that in a way which is robust and proper. That is in part due to the collapse of these institutions, but the Minister himself has been rather tardy in bringing these forward, because the deadline for this, regardless of the collapse of the institutions, was the 20th of February, and we knew that this needed done since we were elected last May. So there was every opportunity for due process and scrutiny to take place, but it seems that everything in this place has to be subject to last-minute rush, back-of-the-envelope calculations, and perhaps we wouldn't be sitting here where we are today if that culture were to end. It seems that the Minister has been far too busy treating his department like his own personal fiefdom and running around finding lost cash down the back of magic sofas over recent days to be able to actually direct his attention to the business of his department. And I think that there is a serious disconnect between the concerns that his department has responsibility for and the amount of interest that he has shown over the last 8 months for those responsibilities. And I think that the public will see that very clearly in how late we are in coming to what is such a serious issue. I am also concerned, Mr. Speaker, because in what was said by Carl McKillen here today, it raises serious issues about what weight we can give to what the Finance Minister has said on the airwaves and in terms of personal reassurances to those of us who raised concerns about access to funding during this period. It is our understanding that there is the power within the current regulations for civil servants to be able to deal with an emergency budget. That is 75% of what would have been last year. So you can imagine what 75% of what would have been last year, the impact that could have. But what is not clear is whether accruing resources are subject to the same access. Those accruing resources cover issues like pensions,
Could I ask the member to come back to the regulations?
Well, Mr. Speaker, you would have more authority in doing so had you done the same with your party colleague, Paul Givan, when I pointed out that he had wandered somewhat further from the matter under discussion than I have on this occasion. If I could, Mr. Speaker, point out that my concern is about protecting the same vulnerable people that we are here to protect, those who are in receipt of benefits, those who need those accruing resources in order to survive, many of whom will be people who are on pensions and may find themselves in difficulties if it is not resolved. We have a situation where there is now no clarity on that issue and no trust and confidence, frankly, in the word being given by either minister, because we have not been able to properly scrutinise it. I have to say that for those who are living with this fear, for those who are living without the reassurance, this is a sorry state of affairs for people who are supposed to be responsible ministers who will continue to draw their salary over the next number of weeks, but who have behaved irresponsibly over the last week in ramping up tensions on these issues. No, I will not give way. Who have ramped up tensions on these issues over the last weeks on the airwaves and have failed in what they have said today to create any more confidence. We will be supporting these regulations. We do so with significant reservations, having not been in a position to scrutinise them properly. But we do so because we believe that it is the only way that we as a party can do our utmost to ensure that no one can hold us accountable for this fiasco.
I call Mr. Christopher Stalford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm supporting the regulations, obviously. One of the reasons why I got involved in politics is because... No. One of the reasons why I got involved in politics is because I come from a working-class community. I was born in Annadale, reared at the bottom of the Ravenhill Road. And I can see communities that are in need, and I wanted to make a difference to help them. It's wrong that people should be fearful for their future. It's wrong that 34,000 people in Northern Ireland should have been facing the very real prospect of the implementation of this tax upon them. Mitigations were first negotiated way back by Nelson McCausland when he was at DSD. And working constructively along with others, we managed to put those mitigations in place. I think that was the right thing to do. I think it was right that Northern Ireland should have a tailored solution that protects vulnerable people from the introduction of the bedroom tax. I listened to Carol McKillen and the contribution that she made, and in it she made a defence of Sinn Féin's policy of abstentionism in terms of abstaining from going to Westminster. She made that defence. We've now moved from abstaining from being in Westminster to actually abstaining from exercising any power or control in Northern Ireland. Please don't heckle me from a sedentary position. I didn't do that to you. Show some manners and decorum. We'll then exercise them. The fact is that in Westminster they don't go, and now they've decided that they don't want to go to the executive in Stormont. And the power to protect the most vulnerable people in Northern Ireland will be undermined by not having a functioning government here in order to put in place measures such as the mitigations to the bedroom tax. Devolution can be used for the benefit of the people, and particularly vulnerable people. And I think it's unfortunate, therefore, that others have decided that they want to abstain from using the power available to them. That is their choice, and we live in a democracy, and they're free to do so. But let us also not forget that because of their posturing over the issue of welfare reform, £174 million in 2 years was lost to the people of Northern Ireland. That's money that could have been spent. Yes, I will.
I thank the member for giving way. Would he clarify his point? Because the money wasn't actually lost to the people of Northern Ireland. It was lost to our block grant, but instead it was paid directly to the people of Northern Ireland.
Well, the block grant pays for the public services that are provided for the people of Northern Ireland, so it was less money to go on essential public services that we're here to deliver. And that happened because Sinn Féin, for their own reasons, decided that they would behave in the way that they did. And for someone to stand up from their benches and say that they're proud of that, I think is remarkable. For someone representing Belfast North, one of the most deprived constituencies in Northern Ireland, to stand up and say they're proud of it simply defies belief. I welcome the fact that these measures are being introduced, but I also want to address the point that was made by Mr. Eastwood, and I think it was an accurate point. We don't know what we're going to be elected to, those of us who are returned. We don't know what these elections will be. It's likely that we won't have devolution. It's likely that at least for an extended period of time, we're being elected to some sort of talks process. That point that Mr. Eastwood raised is right. It therefore means that the people of Northern Ireland will be at the mercy of a Tory government and its direct rule ministers. So anyone that thinks that it's going to simply be a case of collapsing these institutions and then flick of a switch getting them back up again is deluding themselves. And that means that measures such as this, a Northern Ireland tailored solution to protect our constituents, will not be put in place. We will be entirely at the whim of home counties Tories who don't give two figs about the budgetary implications of the cuts that they want to push through. If people are happy with that, that's up to them. They've made their decision. But let us not pretend. Let us not pretend that by doing so, you're standing up for your constituents. You are leaving them at the mercy of a Tory government. I'll give way, yes?
I agree, whilst it's welcome that these regulations safeguard some 34,000 people, it's imperative, whatever institutions that we come back to post-election, that a more long-term strategy is looked at, and that is building enough 1, 2 and 3-bedroom houses, and also looking at mitigation post-2020.
I absolutely do agree with that. I think it's essential that we build more social houses, and that's why I welcome the fact that in the draft programme for government, there was a commitment to build more social houses than we have ever built before. Of course, we won't have a government, so whether or not that target will now be achieved is up in the air. Whether or not a direct rule regime of people from the home counties in the southeast of England will be prepared to see that through and delivered is up in the air. But I absolutely agree with the member in terms of the need to build more social homes. I welcome the fact that the minister has brought these measures forward, and I hope that all parties will support them. It's essential that we use devolution to protect the people in Northern Ireland and to protect the most vulnerable in our society. Those who have decided that they wish to cast devolution aside are leaving the most vulnerable in our society at the mercy of people who don't care about them. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mike Nesbitt.
Sorry, Mr. Speaker, I didn't hear you there.
Mr. Speaker, it wasn't my intention to speak, but I do want to say a few words, having listened carefully to the contributions to date. And I know we appear to be in our last days, or maybe even the last day, according to the Minister, and so with an election looming, I suppose, maintaining a tone that would be well received by the public is challenging. I just want to say a few words about the Ulster Unionist position, because we always hear, thrown up in our faces, 7 years of Conservative rule and austerity. And we've had it today from the two outgoing parties of Stormont Castle. Well, where are they taking us with no budget? Where are they taking the vulnerable of Northern Ireland with no budget and no executive? The Ulster Unionist Party absolutely had our own position on welfare reform and tried to negotiate with the other parties around the table, not least Stormont Castle, Stormont House. But one thing we were sure about was that the bedroom tax was not a good tax in principle and was a bad tax for Northern Ireland. And I think Michael Copeland, when he was our spokesman, demonstrated huge empathy with the vulnerable, as his successor, Andy Allen, has done. And let's remember, Andy faces his own challenges in life. Yes.
I'd like to recall for the House benefit that when we in the Social Development Committee were considering many of these matters, that I actually had to personally go to yourself as a leader on behalf of Michael Copeland. Michael Copeland was fighting the good fight within the committee, but your party or your leadership did not support him. And I had to actually go to speak to you to ask him, you, on behalf of the Ulster Unionist Party, to give some support to Michael Copeland, who wanted to support people against bedroom tax and other welfare cuts, but your party wouldn't support him.
See, this is the point, Mr. Speaker, I was coming on to. You weren't asking about the bedroom tax in isolation. You were lumping it in with other proposals, and as I've already made clear in these opening remarks, we had disagreements on other aspects of welfare. You call them protections. It's politics, Mr. Speaker. We have disagreements, and we try to reach a position. And when we can't reach a unanimous position, the parties of government, the two parties in the castle, they make the call. God help the vulnerable. And you know what? There are people, Mr. Speaker, on benefits who should not be on benefits. And I'm not talking about fraud. I'm talking about mental health and well-being. And I have campaigned on this for 4 or 5 years. And now I have all the parties saying, yeah, we agree. And what have they done? What have they done? They've done nothing. So here's our position on the bedroom tax. We do not have the housing stock to say to somebody living in a multi-bedroom property, you either pay the penalty that is the bedroom tax or you move, because there is nowhere to move to because we don't have the stock. And the reason we think in principle it's a bad idea is that putting on a second bedroom if you're building a new social unit is marginal cost. And those units should be used by 1, 2, 3, 4 families or 1, 2, 3, 4 generations over the course of that home's lifetime. So for flexibility's sake, we think it makes sense to build multi-bedroom properties rather than putting this huge focus, because somebody politically has said it's a good idea to have those single-bedroom properties. So we will support these regulations, and it is consistent with our view on this specific element of welfare reform.
Call Mr. George Robinson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I want to welcome these regulations as they ensure that the most vulnerable in society will have the protection that was promised to them. The Welfare Reform Mitigation Group did an excellent job in highlighting where greater help was required. This was especially so for housing benefit or bedroom tax, as it is popularly known. Mr. Speaker, it is important that we all note that the party who have created the political instability today could have cost the people who require the greatest help this essential benefit, the total cost of which will be around £91 million. I also note that it is a DUP minister who has ensured that this legislation is brought today so no one is adversely impacted upon by the bedroom tax. My own constituency has a high deprivation level, and I am well aware of how devastating the changes to housing benefit would have been if Minister Givan had not taken the action he has taken to protect Northern Ireland and the most vulnerable. There will be many relieved people that the Minister has taken this brave step. Mr. Speaker, I hope all members will support the Housing Benefit Welfare Supplementary Payment Regulations 2017, even those who have jeopardised its very existence. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mr. Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just wanted to speak briefly as a former member of the committee which dealt with a great deal of the work around the introduction of these mitigation measures, and to welcome today the fact that we have the opportunity to mitigate particularly the bedroom tax. Although I think for me, certainly one of the abiding memories of today, as perhaps this institution draws to a close and into a very uncertain future, is a plague on both your houses. Because the reality is that both the Minister and his combative colleague in the other finance ministry who have been arguing on the airways over this matter have neither covered themselves in glory, but what they have done is caused a great deal of anxiety and concern for those who faced into having this tax applied to them, and the disruption, and indeed, as others have said, the inability of social housing to actually provide appropriate accommodation. And so I very much welcome these mitigation regulations. I welcome them because they need to do what it is that they are required to do, which is to ensure that some of the most vulnerable people in our community have the appropriate benefits and money to live on without fear and concern of where this is taking them to. However, these regulations today, Mr. Speaker, come to this House with a very large health warning around them. They come, yes, with the advice and guidance of civil servants, in whom I have a great deal of admiration for the work that they've done in bringing this forward. But they also come with a substantial health warning, and that health warning is that they come without the scrutiny of a committee. And as I understand, unless the Minister can tell us otherwise, they also come without the scrutiny of the Examiner of Statutory Rules. And that is a very risky situation. But it is also my understanding, and this is why we will be supporting these regulations today, that if anything goes awry, and I hope it doesn't, in the regulations being brought into force, that the responsibility lies solely and squarely with the Minister for any fault in these regulations. Thank you.
I call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I have to say, I hate to see politicians use the most vulnerable for their own political ends. The sham fight that took place between the Finance Minister and the Communities Minister over the bedroom tax was nothing short of a disgrace. 34,000 people have seen them toy with their financial security for their own political ends, particularly coming at a time after Christmas when people already are struggling. People are already facing debt, facing financial insecurity. I'll finish the point, I'll give way. To exacerbate that by playing out a fight about their incomes in the media, I think reflects badly on us all. I'll give way to Mr. Dirk.
I thank the member for giving way and certainly concur that the actions and words of both ministers have heightened confusion and concern. Although I would say that they have done so among much more than the 34,000 people who will be protected, thankfully now protected. There are a lot of people out there, pensioners, who aren't included in this 34,000 because they are exempt but don't yet realise that they are. So the chaos, I think, has been actually understated, the distress that this has caused. I just wonder if the member would agree with me, and I think you know the answer to this, that the best way to have avoided that confusion, that worry that this has caused, would have been for this Assembly to remove in its entirety from the Welfare Reform Bill Clause 69. And in both attempts that my party attempted to do so, that was the 10th of February last year and the 24th of February last year, the only support that we got was from the member himself.
I thank the member for his point, because it was a point I was going to come to. The Green Party is committed to doing what is right to protect the most vulnerable, which is why we have consistently opposed all legislation proposed to introduce the bedroom tax in Northern Ireland. And we're the only party, along with the SDLP, who consistently did so. So we had the opportunity through this Assembly to bring forward bespoke legislation for Northern Ireland. We had the opportunity to say we will not legislate for the bedroom tax in Northern Ireland. But unfortunately, whilst others may wring their hands today and purport their opposition to the bedroom tax, when it came to opposing it in this House, when it came to preventing such legislation coming forward to the Northern Ireland Assembly, there were only two parties, the SDLP and the Green Party, who stood up to say no to the bedroom tax. I'll give way to Ms Long.
I thank the member for giving way, and I apologise to Carol McKillen for not giving way to her earlier, which I ought to have done. Would the member not agree with me that one of the reasons that we are in the fix that we're in today is because the RHI scheme, which is worth £1 billion over 20 years, broke parity with Westminster without being properly budgeted, and therefore plunged us into the crisis that we're in with £20 million a year of costs. Had we done what you are suggesting, were one element of welfare, DLA on its own, has exceeded £1 billion per year. Had we broken parity, we would have bankrupted Northern Ireland almost overnight. These mitigation measures were the best way of addressing the problem.
I thank the member for her intervention, and I accept that she wasn't in the Assembly when we were debating she wasn't here when we were debating welfare reform in the Northern Ireland Assembly. I brought forward 23 amendments to that legislation. I did not, at the outset, say no to all and any welfare reform. What I did do was seek, through reasonable amendments, to make things better in Northern Ireland, not through a system of copy and paste the Tory regulation, which her party supported, and introduce it into Northern Ireland legislation. Instead, I said, let's have bespoke legislation for Northern Ireland, because it's not right to put the legislation into place first and mitigate after. What is right is to get the legislation right first and not have to mitigate. So it wasn't no to any legislation. It wasn't no to any reform. What it was better legislation for Northern Ireland and better for the people of Northern Ireland. In ceding power back to Westminster on this issue, we wasted the opportunity to provide a better deal here. So whilst I welcome the mitigation measures, ultimately, they provide security only for the next 4 years and leave many people unsure as to what will happen post-2020. And it also means that we arise at this situation where we're having to effectively pass emergency legislation to ensure that those people are protected, even in the short term. I'll give way.
Do you accept that through the whole debate of welfare reform that you, like our party, was therefore trying to push us through as quickly as possible to protect people? But you know that people constantly refer to this 4 years. But my understanding is that one Assembly cannot commit another Assembly out of the package. And there was always a built-in review there that allowed you to pick it up so that the thing could be continued on. Would you accept that?
I accept the member's point that there is the possibility, after 4 years, of renewing mitigation measures. What there isn't is the certainty, and the certainty would have been provided by not legislating for the bedroom tax. I'll give way to Mr. Scott.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. Whilst Mr. McCann's right to say one assembly cannot bind another, would the member also agree with me that one assembly most certainly cannot bind a directorial regime presided over by a Conservative government?
I agree once again with the member, and I hope it doesn't come to that. I think it was regrettable that we ceded power back to Westminster in welfare reform. I would suggest we shouldn't be ceding any more power by failing the people of Northern Ireland, by failing to find a political solution to our current impasse. My concern, and it comes back to the point about what happens post-2020, is that it was always the intention of the DUP to phase in welfare reform. Again, their purported opposition, or sorry, to phase in bedroom tax, their purported opposition to it did come late in the day. And as I say, they were prepared to pass the legislation in this House. And I quote then Minister Mervyn Storey when we discussed this issue during, I think it was consideration stage, of the welfare reform debate, and he said, "The executive have agreed to create a separate fund that will mitigate the impact of this measure," referring to the bedroom tax, "by protecting existing and future tenants from any reduction in their housing benefit, unless there is significant change in their circumstances or they are offered suitable alternative accommodation." So it was the intention of the then minister to still apply the bedroom tax where people had a change in circumstance or were offered alternative accommodation. So it wasn't complete opposition, and it wasn't no bedroom tax ever. And that is my concern, that beyond 2020 that we will see the introduction of the bedroom tax in Northern Ireland, as was legislated for by Westminster, as was mitigated against for 4 years, but as there's uncertainty beyond that. So I do welcome the legislation today to provide a temporary protection for those who are vulnerable to the provisions of the bedroom tax. But the question remains, how long will this be mitigated against? And why did we not take the opportunity? Why did we waste the opportunity to have bespoke Northern Ireland legislation that would have said no definitively to the bedroom tax? The Green Party continues to oppose the welfare cuts and will continue to take every opportunity to do so.
Call Mr. Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think Mr. Agnew made the most salient point when he said that after 4 years, he put it more strongly than anybody else, the bedroom tax will be alive and well and being imposed here on the people of the North. At that stage, of course, it might be more than 34,000 people that are affected by it. How do we know? But, you know, the one part where I disagree with Mr. Agnew is where he said after 4 years, we'll have to legislate again. No, we won't, Stephen. We won't have to legislate again. The point is that if things are left as they are, if there's no legislation to cover the period after 1920, then the bedroom tax will automatically be opposed. Let us be absolutely clear about it. People say we got rid of the bedroom tax. I'm not terribly interested in the argument, increasingly heated, between, you know, sort of the two biggest parties about who's responsible for getting rid, as they claim, wrongly, of the bedroom tax. Right, I was roundly abused by a member of the DUP, sort of over the weekend, sorry, because I wouldn't give them full credit for having, as they put it, got rid of the bedroom tax. We have not got rid of the bedroom tax. The bedroom tax is here. The different sort of situation previously is that the executive, the state, is paying the bedroom tax for the 34,000 people that we have mentioned. But the bedroom tax itself is here. And the only difference will be after what will come after the year 2020, particularly come after, is how is it going to be paid and by whom? But it's here. So can we give over with this stuff about who got rid of the bedroom tax? None of you got rid of the bedroom tax. But I say all this, I was surely I, Mark.
member for giving way, and certainly would concur with his verdict that the bedroom tax hasn't gone away. You know, he refers to the £500 million, as have other parties bragged about the fact that they secured £500 million for these mitigations. But this isn't a new £500 million. Would the member concur with me that this is money that is coming from other public services?
Absolutely, absolutely. And this is not a matter of politics, it's a matter of reading, it's a matter of arithmetic. That's what it is. I mean, he's absolutely a correct in all that. I would draw attention to one when we say that these mitigations will apply in the interim, sort of until we have to come back to it in 2019 or 2020. If you look at the top of page 2 of this document, draft statutory rules of Northern Ireland, housing benefit, welfare, etc., the one that was distributed yesterday. It says, but a person's entitlement to a welfare supplementary payment ceases, even though the person continues to be entitled to housing benefit, if A, the person moves to a dwelling, the landlord of which is either the housing executive or a registered housing association, and B, the number of bedrooms in that dwelling exceeds the permitted number of bedrooms by at least the same number as the number of bedrooms in the dwelling from which the person moved, if that exceeded the permitted number immediately before the move. Now, it's a wee bit tangled, as these documents and legal documents tend to be. But sort of the people, a very small number of people, will be affected by this. The type of people who will be affected by it, the circumstances in which it will arise, is, for example... Of course.
Thank you, Mr. McCann, for giving way, because I know he's in full flow there and it's important he makes the relevant points that he wants to make. But just to go back to the origins of this, for the record, this executive, with all the faults and all the failings that people have identified, including ourselves, did make available from the block grant, because we couldn't get it out of Tories in London. We made the political choice to spend over £500 million over a four-year period, after which there will be a full review as to the efficacy of any of those payments or any of those supplementary payments. We made that £500+ million available over 4 years, and we gave it over to an independent panel led by Professor Eileen Evison and other eminent members of the wider community and voluntary and professional sector. Those people identified the best way of protecting the most vulnerable from that pool of money of over £500 million. And I'm just making a point and asking the member, would he not agree that at least those 34,000 people that you talk about and other parties here are lamenting about their worries over the last number of weeks, but voted against the money to pay for the mitigation measures, and whatever way they argue, they still voted against the £500 million plus benefits that we put forward to subsidise against British Tory cuts being imposed by London. No other party in this House, whenever they objected and voted against the £500 million plus package, not one member of any of those other parties actually offered or proposed or suggested an extra single pound to come out of any other part of the budget to go towards further mitigations, which we would have been welcoming of supporting. So at least acknowledge, at least acknowledge that this executive paid for out of the budget, yes, but that's because all of the civic sector and all the political parties couldn't force the British government to backtrack. This party and the other party across the House, whether we like it or not, made £500 million available to welfare protection.
When the member asks and is conceded for an intervention, the intervention should be short.
Well, I say to Alex, sorry, you know, I am not going to get involved sort of in a complex and heated row sort of between his party and other parties. I wasn't here when all this happened. I have acknowledged that. I have acknowledged that, and it's on that basis, let me say, that we will not be resisting sort of or opposing this measure, because it does, as you say, provide some mitigation. My point is an additional one going on from that, to mention the fact that I mentioned the circumstances, sort of, and I know that the provision which I read out sort of wasn't able to take in, but that's the language very easily, but that's the language in the document. What I mean, the people, the sort of people that it will apply to is, for example, a single mother with three children, relationship breaks up, wants to move house to somewhere near her own family, near her mum maybe, or whatever. They will be vulnerable to this, to use the word that everybody else is using, vulnerable. Yes, Christopher, come on.
I'm grateful for the member for giving way. He's been very generous with his time. Having been subjected to that little sermon from Mr. Maskey about the mitigations that we put in, would the member agree with me that it then defies belief that you would remove the one mechanism whereby you were able to put mitigations in to protect people, namely the Northern Ireland Executive?
Well, again, you know, that's an argument between an EUP and Sinn Féin, sort of, and I let a member of Sinn Féin respond to that. But it's worth commenting, sort of, as we go by, sort of, at almost anything we say here, if there's an intervention from Sinn Féin or from the DUP, it is against the other major party. That we're hearing, I mean, this has had, you know, the amount of finger-pointing, sort of, amount of denunciation, sort of, of one and the other, the harsh words spoken by each, and none of them can deny that. You know, that's been the tone of this discussion so far. How distant seem the days when Arlene Foster and Martin McGuinness were co-authoring documents sort of in the local press, telling us how wonderfully well everything was going, sort of, and how destructive sort of people were who suggested that there were really fundamental problems with this place. And now, just what, 3 months later, since that article sort of was released, we have the spectacle sort of that we've had this morning. People talk about the dysfunctionality and all this. What they're referring to is the fact that we've got two parties with different ideologies who basically hate one another and hate what one another stand for, lashed together sort of in an executive, sort of locked together in a loveless embrace from which they cannot escape. So that's why we've had all this chaos over recent weeks. It's not just to do with the particular circumstances in which things broke down sort of, over the RHI scheme and so forth. You see, one of the solutions to be mentioned before, I forget by whom, that one of the things that would provide proper mitigation, sort of, and really provide a solution, would be if we had a sufficient number of social houses in Northern Ireland. That's what we saw. If we had a crash programme of building social housing by direct state intervention in the economy and in the housing market, we could solve this problem, or at least move very quickly towards a solution to the problem. Where will we get the money for that? Well, why not get rid of the stupid idea of abolishing corporation tax at a cost of hundreds of millions of pounds with no guarantee whatsoever, no guarantee that one job will be created as a result? Could we put that money into a crash programme for building social housing? I hesitate to mention the 490 million quid which has gone up in smoke, but that would have helped too. And other money, sort of, which are used sort of for purposes, the social relevance of which is far from clear to me. And if you did that, Mr. Speaker, if you did sort of build houses, the state build the houses again, it had a number of effects. One is it would reduce the housing benefit bill substantially at a saving to the public purse. It also would have this effect, that if you're building houses, I made this point in this house before, but I make it again because I think it's absolutely key to what we are talking about, and when we talk about the cost of housing for ordinary people, sort of, and how they can be helped to afford it, and all the rest of it. If you had that up, that sort of programme of house building, just think about it for a minute, fellow members of the Assembly. What do you need to build houses? What do you need? Well, you need land, don't you? And you need bricks and so on. You need a lot of workers to put the houses together. You need bricklayers. You need carpenters. You need plumbers. You need painters. You need electricians. You need roofers. You need glaziers. You need a range of people with those old traditional skills that we are losing. Putting them to work as well, bringing apprentices in and so forth into that, would have a significant effect sort of on the economic well-being of this area, right? But also on the economic well-being of any of the citizens here. Of course, yeah.
Way, and I completely agree with everything you're saying, particularly around protections, particularly in the public procurement programmes. I'm just wondering why then his party colleague stood outside Casement Park when £80 million of investment was going into the worst deprived area with all those protections for local people. So is it okay for building social houses but not for building dreams for people in the GAA?
Well, you know, I mean, I thought I was saying, Carol, come on. I mean, that's a different issue. That's which you know, as you know, you come from the area.
What is
No, but you come there, you know sort of that the issue there had to do sort of with the acceptability or otherwise of the stadium and the proportions sort of in the way that it was proposed. Sorry? I'm certainly not supporting it in the sense and the scale in which it was introduced and so forth, but I'm not from there. You know an awful lot more about it than I, and I suspect that Jerry Carroll knows as much as you, sort of, and local people do. So I leave it to them, sort of, in the interests of democracy. And I don't think that the position that we would take up in relation to the casement refurbishment, I don't think that any of those positions are directly relevant to what we are saying here today. People are not disqualified from taking one attitude or the other to the matter before us today, dependent on where they stood in relation to casement park. What I will say is this, you know, that this has been my final point. I'm struck by the number of people who have spoken, the number of members have spoken, who have had concerns about the most vulnerable. We use this phrase all the time. This will affect the most vulnerable. And of course there's a certain kindness in that. You know, sort of say it's difficult to object to the language, except in this sense. These people are referred to all the time as if they are helpless, as if they are people to whom we have to go and bail them out, sort of forgive them, take them by the hand, sort of, and lead them towards the promised land. They are regarded as spectators at politics. Sort of, but we have to help the most vulnerable and not hit them. I don't see them as the most vulnerable. I see the people that you're referring to as the basis for challenging sort of the divided nature of our politics and the divided nature of this House, which has given rise to the present hiatus. And I hope they'll be able to say more about this sort of before this day is out, sort of in relation to two of the other items that are coming before us. I say to people who are being oppressed by poverty, that's what we mean when we say vulnerable people, that's mainly what we mean. We're talking about people who don't have an adequate means of living. That's what it is. It's poverty is that problem. Lack of resources in individual families. That's what's going on when we consider that problem. And I say to people in that position, yes, listen to the debates here. Yes, read all the documents and so on. It's good. It's good to understand the detail on these things. But if you want real change, organise yourself to demand real change. The only time we've had progressive change of any substantial nature in this country, in this part of the world, is when people got together, campaigned together for it.
Mr. McCann, I have been very liberal. I understand the debate is taking place today within particular political circumstances, but I would ask members, all members, to return to the scope of the debate around the regulations.
Okay, I'm nearly finished, actually, you know, but I do think in relation to this, Mr. Speaker, and to some of the other things before us, it's impossible to understand the issues which arise in relation to these things without seeing it in the overall context of economic policy, generally, sort of, and the funds made available, whether from Westminster or from Stormont. So I'll just say this in the end. There's an awful lot of in agreement here, you know, as well as bickering and finger-pointing. You know, everybody agrees we must support the most vulnerable. Well, there's arguments about how we reach the present situation with regard to the bedroom tax. Everybody seems agreed. I don't think there's anybody who has failed to say that they want to look after the most vulnerable, and even that they enter politics precisely for the reason of defending the least well off and so forth. Hello, brothers and sisters. You know, sort of, I sometimes got the impression that we all want to storm the citadels of capitalism, even though there's some disagreement about who has got the right to lead the charge. And I say that the people who should lead the charge are the people most affected by it. And I call on people outside this House, in the situation that we're moving into, however it is. And if there is, sort of, at the end of... Okay, let's just deal with one other thing, sort of, before I finish, Mr. Speaker. It only lasts 4 years, and I think it was Alex who said... Well, of course, that's all we could do, you know, sort of, that's the end of the mandate and so forth. And I replied, sorry, that's my point exactly. I want everybody to understand this. Can we please have nobody else talking about we've got rid of the bedroom tax? We have not got rid of the bedroom tax. The bedroom tax is here. That's the fact of the matter, and we could have a more sensible and objective debate if everybody accepted that and moved on the basis of that. So let's try to do that, Mr. Speaker. As I say, I direct my remarks mainly at people outside here. I direct my lecture to the people directly affected by these matters. But as we move forward in the debate, and I'm sure, Mr. Speaker, in the circumstances in which we all find ourselves, I mean, you would be happy to chair sort of an informed and I hope I haven't attacked anybody personally or unfairly in political terms. I think if we could proceed like that on an understanding and an acceptance that the bedroom tax is already here.
Call Mr. Jonathan Bell.
Mr. Speaker, they say a society can rightly be judged by how it looks after its most vulnerable members. I will not use any time allocated to me in this House to attack any fellow MLA. I think there's been enough of that. I will attack the principle of those who would abuse social justice. We should be, everyone in this House, if we use the law of physics, and we realise in engineering terms that a chain is only as strong as its weakest link, then we will know that there are many people in our society, often through no fault of their own, who find themselves in a position of disadvantage, who find themselves in a position where they have families that they are responsible for, and they have housing needs, which is one of the most basic of all human rights. I think we were correct in earlier debates in this House when we looked towards numbers of social houses being predicted by the Housing Executive and others of 8,800. I think we were right to say, look, let's go and try and do better. And we did that, and we sought to seek the 9,600. Is it adequate? There's always going to be an infinite demand on the public service to be met by a finite level of public resource. But when we look towards social justice, we have to look towards the money that has been allocated to us and our stewardship of that money. Later today, we'll look at one of the most gravest financial scandals, the Renewable Heat Initiative, which will and is proposed to cost the taxpayer £1,200 million. But we'll turn to that. I haven't spoken on it since I made one programme. I'll speak to it again later today. The measures that are before us have to look at how we can give merit to people to mitigate against the disadvantage that they endure. We cannot spend the same pound twice. It's not the time for Alice in Wonderland politics and pretend that there is money out there that we don't have, because all you do is you lead the most vulnerable people into a sense of false hope that something can be done when everyone in this House knows it can't be done. I want to pay tribute to Professor Ian Evison and her team and those who had the vision before to look to what devolution could do for Northern Ireland. And in Professor Evison, we have one of the most foremost experts, I would say, in the British Isles in terms of welfare policy, examining on our behalf how we could help the most vulnerable in our society. We all wanted to do more, but we were determined never to make the perfect the enemy of the possible. Let me say that again. We were determined never to make the perfect the enemy of the possible. All of us would have wanted to have done more, but we weren't going to let that want stop us doing anything at all. And I think the measures that have been brought forward have been very carefully crafted. I have watched civil servants, some of whom are here in the House today, both at committee level and at other times when I had the privilege of sitting in the Northern Ireland Executive, work through in detail, long into the night and into the early hours of the morning, what could be done. And that's why I welcome these proposals being brought forward today, because the proposals brought before us today are the best possible answer from Northern Ireland to the people who are oppressed. And that is a strong word, but it is a right word. There are people out there who are oppressed by poverty. I, like Christopher Stalford, grew up in working class Belfast. We know what it was like in those days to be given a different colour of dinner ticket than the next person. But that's because a society then decided for those of us that there was a need to give help to families. Now when we come to the issue of social housing and regulations that can help people. There is no alternative to do but to go with these regulations here today. Because in so doing, we will have given the very best people to the most oppressed people. And it should hurt all of us, and it should anger all of us, as I believe it angers God when people are socially oppressed by poverty and have difficulty to find a house for their families and to deal with the very basics of shelter. I like the fact that the measures are merited. I like the fact that the measures are targeted. And I like the fact that in every way that I have looked at this, due to the expertise that we have within our civil service, we will be delivering today for the most vulnerable people, I believe, and from all sides of the House, the best that we can do with the circumstances that are available to us. Mr. Speaker, I started by saying that we must always stand by those who are the most vulnerable in our society. I can see no better way to do it than to do what is now proposed.
I call the Minister for Communities, Mr. Paul Givan, to conclude and wind up on the debate. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And my sense is that despite all that's went on today by way of content of the speeches, that people are going to support these regulations. And I think that the public will appreciate that, that despite all that has went on, parties can set aside the party politicking that everyone has engaged in. You know, people say that I engaged in party politics. Of course I did. Sinn Féin have engaged in it, as has every other party. Given the day that it is, not surprising. But despite all of that, we will pass regulations now that will protect those individuals who would have been facing the consequences of the bedroom tax being introduced from the financial reality of that. And I was very clear that I was not prepared to use the bedroom tax during the course of any political campaign the way in which it would have been had we not taken the measures today. And I had spent night and day engaging with my officials, solutions to try and get round the fact that there is no executive for me to bring a regulation to. I regret the fact that the Finance Minister went and engaged publicly around all of this. On Thursday, when I had identified the way forward, I rang the Finance Minister. I spoke to him personally. I said to him that I had identified a way forward, and I said what that regulation, the approach that we're now taking today, would be the way forward. He indicated to me he would take it to his department and come back to me. His response? To publish his permanent secretary's advice on social media. Indicative of the way in which Sinn Féin have been handling these issues over the course of the last week. Because there is a very clear agenda, much bigger than bedroom tax, much bigger than RHI, around the objectives that they have, which Barry McAlduff summed up very well in his tweet. Comrade Martin, he stands with him in his resignation to achieve a united Ireland. We know, unionists know what Sinn Féin are doing. Unionists know exactly now what the Republican agenda is. And Mr. Speaker, on bedroom tax, I'm not prepared to allow that to be used during the course of this debate, this campaign that's going to be happening. To confirm what the member for Foyle said, bedroom tax is coming in to Northern Ireland. Sinn Féin agreed to it. Sinn Féin agreed to the introduction of the bedroom tax. They agreed to that. Subsequently, we agreed to mitigate the consequences of the bedroom tax being introduced. An example, as Alex Maskey outlined, how this executive was able to deal with issues that are important to our people. But to be factually correct, the bedroom tax is being brought into Northern Ireland, and Sinn Féin agreed to it. We then agreed in the executive to mitigate against it, which other parties voted against. And that's the factual position in respect to it. Let me make some progress, and I will give way. In respect of other comments that members have made, I share the concern that Naomi Long and Stuart Dixon raised around the lack of scrutiny in respect of this regulation. I agree. There has not been the normal scrutiny that we should be giving as an institution to these regulations. Associated with that, then, is an element of risk. And I, as Minister, am not going to be saying that there isn't that element of risk, because I engaged with the Office of Legislative Counsel to get these regulations drafted, but those points about scrutiny are well made. But given the circumstances that I am in, I believe it is right for me to lay these regulations and MLAs to vote on it. I'll give way to Ms. Long.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for giving way. On that point, would the Minister agree with me that if and when this Assembly is re-established, it would be wise for the Communities Committee retrospectively to properly examine these regulations, as if there are any issues with them, that risk could be mitigated at that point, at the earliest possible point?
I agree to that, because I agree that should the examiner for statutory rules, as has happened before in regulations, identified that there could be issues, that is something that obviously this Assembly would need to deal with. So people need to be honest in this debate. I need to be, I will be, I always am. These regulations are the best option in the circumstances that we face, but they are by no means the most appropriate option in a normal functioning democracy by way of taking legislation through and the scrutiny that requires. I trust that, given the response made by Sinn Féin, that I regret the way in which the Finance Minister engaged on this. But ultimately, Mr. Speaker, I was right and he was wrong. He was wrong in terms of the advice that he gave. And therefore, his credibility has been shot to pieces as he has went out repeatedly on a whole range of issues, making promises. And this approach that I am taking, that members will vote on, shoots his credibility through the floor. He has been wrong, and wrong on a whole range of issues. And rather than actually trying, as I have done in the unprecedented circumstances, deal with bedroom tax, and my executive colleague, Mr. Hamilton, to deal with RHI, and we are bringing regulations forward, he should have been engaging in getting a budget through as an emergency procedure. But again, more important to Sinn Féin is the Republican agenda, which goes to the core of what their tactics have been and what this election is all about. I said I would give way to Mr. Durkin.
I thank the Minister for giving way. We've gone a bit further than when I wanted to get in. The Minister made a point, and it's a point that's been made by party colleagues of his own and from his estranged partners in government, about other parties, every other party in this chamber, voting against £500 million mitigation fund. What parties voted against was the Fresh Start Agreement that was foisted upon other executive parties at the time, I have to say, 25 minutes or half an hour before an executive meeting. This element of Fresh Start, very good, brilliant. Who would oppose mitigation against these draconian measures? However, we weren't in the position to cherry-pick bits of it, and the other bits of it have well and truly unravelled, and that's evident for everyone in here, everyone out there, and everyone right across the world to see that the Fresh Start was a false dawn, and look where we are now.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'll not repeat the points, because today's going to be an incredibly long day, I have no doubt about that. I've put on record the factual position about the bedroom tax is coming, it will be here, and the mitigation that this executive rightly brought in and other parties voted against because they were opposed to that agreement that allowed the mitigation measures to flow from it. But also, we have been working on a whole range of mitigation measures. One of them that hasn't been brought forward, and again the plan to introduce that, is the Working Tax Allowance, for example. Low-paid workers. Without an assembly, we will not be able to introduce a scheme that would allow approximately around £100 million that was proposed by Eileen Everson to be spent out of that half a billion block. The stakes are incredibly high for these institutions. Incredibly high for these institutions. And I don't underestimate, Mr. Speaker, the challenges in dealing with those mitigation measures in the future. But let's be under no illusion. the stakes are high for the very future of this Assembly. I believe wholeheartedly in devolution. People said that we weren't able to make it work, and we did for the past 10 years. And this party, Mr. Speaker, introducing a whole range of measures, were able to make this place work. But Sinn Féin, for other reasons, because they don't see their agenda being advanced, now believe that they can use other issues to weaken unionism. I trust the people of Northern Ireland. I never fear going to the electorate. And I believe they know exactly the agenda being pursued by Sinn Féin. This party wants this place to work. We want devolution to succeed. I do not want to have direct rule, but I am very clear. We are going into a period of negotiations. Sinn Féin want weak unionists. I trust the people to elect the right unionists. I beg the move.
Members, the question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Is question time. I therefore propose, by leave of the Assembly, to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. The sitting is suspended.
Any indication to you or your office of the intention from the Minister for Finance and the Minister for Health to attend question time and answer questions about their departments today?
I took that as a point of order first thing this morning from a member down here. I have no indication that the two ministers will not be attending, and it isn't actually a matter for the Speaker's office in any case. I'm sorry, I took the point of order from Mr. Stafford because it was right on the suspension. We are now suspended.